life. Pastor Mark and I went to a homegoing celebration service yesterday, and as I sat there and saw the casket before us, I said, God, I just want to thank you for life. I thank you, God, despite whatever it is that we are going through. I thank you for life, Lord. I thank you for life. I thank you for life. You know, nothing else matters, but I thank you for life. So this morning, there is no difference because God has a word for us. And as we stepped into 2024, last week, I spoke on new levels. It's a new level. It's a new dawning. It's a next level. And we're only 7 days in. And I tell you that it's already an amount of things that are happening all around us. But God says this morning that He has the final say, and He has a word for us. And that word today is God's brand. As I lay before God and everything that has taken place in the past 7 days, God says, my brand. What is my brand? So the title today is God's brand. God's brand. I pray that you get your papers and your pen because, you know, God has a word for each and every one of us that's hidden within His brand. So the scripture today is taken from 1 Peter 2, 1 through 12, and we read that for our scripture reading today. But I feel the need to reiterate what the word of the Lord says. And 1 Peter 2, 1 through 12 read as thus. So get rid of all evil behavior. Be done with all deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, and all unkind speech. Like newborn babes, you must crave pure spiritual milk so that you will grow into a full experience of salvation. Cry out for this nourishment now that you have had a taste of the Lord's kindness. You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priest. Through the meditation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. As the scriptures say, I am placing a cornerstone in Jerusalem, chosen for great honor, and anyone who trusts in him will never be disgraced. Yes. You who trust in him recognize the honor God has given him. But for those who reject him, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. And he is the stone that makes people stumble, the rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they do not obey God's word. So they need the faith that was planned for them. But you are not like that. For you are a chosen people. You are royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. Once you received no mercy, now you have received God's mercy. Dear friends, and in some other translation, it said, beloved, I warn you as temporary residents and foreigners to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your very soul. Be careful to live properly among your unbelieving neighbors, then even if they accuse you of doing wrong, they will see your honorable behavior and they will give honor to God when He judges the world. Let's pray. Most holy and most righteous Father, I just want to thank you this morning. I want to thank you for your presence, Lord. I want to thank you for your download. I want to thank you for your word that you have imparted here today, Lord God. And I pray, Lord God, that as it is poured out upon your people will be transformed and renewed, and their lives will be changed for the better. Father God, as I decrease and you increase, have your way and speak. Eek, because your servants hear it, oh God. I give you thanks and praise right now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. As I said, the title of today's sermon is God's Wrath. So, as I said, we are 7 days into 2024, and there's been so much already taking place in such a short period of time, with the battlegrounds drawn and marked. I will not use divisive words, but a call to action for self-evaluation with a simple thought of God's brand. So, in a world saturated with logos and trademarks and personal brand and brand identity, because you see, I've spent 30 years into marketing. And so all these things are everything that I do every single day. Logos, trademarks, personal brand, brand identity. It's easy to lose sight of the ultimate brand. And the ultimate brand is the brand of God Almighty. I want you to know that I don't think, and I will not use the word this morning that I think, because I think is a passive term. It gives room for doubts. It gives room for wavering. So I will not use the term I think, but I, Carleen Angela Hepburn, have an attitude about it, because the essence of God's brand is not a symbol or a slogan. It's an embodiment of love, compassion, boundless and unmerited grace. God's brand isn't a mark. It's a living, breathing presence that transcends the tangible and touches the depth of our souls. The logo of God's brand, when you have an encounter, resonates with every heart, irrespective of language, color, class, creed, or culture. It is a universal emblem, one that represents unity, forgiveness, and the eternal cycle of renewal. It's a brand that stands alone, the test of time, unwavering and constant in a world of fleeting trends. The tagline of God's brand is love unconditional and mercy everlasting. These are not catchy or cliche phrases, but eternal truth that echo through the ages. They are the guiding principles of a brand that surpasses all earthly notions of success or recognition. The product line of God's brand, unlike the commodities of this world, are spiritual treasures called forgiveness, salvation, and the promise of eternal life. These cannot be bought, meaning no bartering, as my daughter would learn in fourth grade. There's no bartering, or sold, but gifts freely given to all who earnestly seek him. The customer service of God's brand is not an automated interactive voice response. We call it the IVR hotline, a chatbot, or a generative artificial intelligence, but a personal relationship forged through prayer and fasting, and a sincere, intimate connection with the Most High God, Yahweh. The support system is omnipresent. It's everywhere. Just this morning on the digital platform, we're in St. Lucia, we're in Jamaica, we're in the United States, across all states, and in the UK. So therefore, he's omnipresent. He's everywhere, not restricted by time or space, offering solace in times of trouble. and guidance in moments of confusion. In the marketplace, God's brand is not about competition, but about who are willing to come. 1 Timothy 2:3-4 says, "This is good and pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. It invites all to partake in the abundance of love and grace. The advertising strategy is not flashy billboards, cashy jingles, or club music. We think it's a good way to draw this generation, but it's a quiet whisper of the wind, the gentle hush of leaves, the awe-inspiring beauty of creation, and most importantly, the good news, God's love." That's it. That's the introduction today. That's God's brand. So what does God's word say? When God drove me to 1 Peter 2:1-12, Peter explains how believers should live amid a world that rejects the message. We should be a witness to the gospel in a way that pleases God, not man. We should be a witness to the gospel in a way that pleases God and not man. I said to my daughter this week, when all of the sound bites went viral, as we would call it, she said, "Mom, I'm confused." I said, "Don't be." I said, "There's only one statement I have to you is, who are you loyal to? Are you loyal to God or are you loyal to man?" And I want everybody to write that down. Who are you loyal to? Are you loyal to man or are you loyal to God? Because when we bear witness of the gospel in a way that pleases God, we are loyal to God. There is no in between. There is no ambiguity. It's very clear. It's very simple. So we who have trusted in Christ bear witness to the gospel by our conduct. We who are trusted in Christ bear witness to the gospel by our conduct. And we are exhorted in 1 Peter 2:11. It says, "I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts." Paraphrasing. In Ephesians 5:15, it says, "See then that he walks circumspectly." In 1 Corinthians 9:24, "So run that you may obtain." Spurgeon, a great theologian, weighed in and he paraphrased and says that Peter puts his hands together and pleads with intense earnestness. "For you belong not to the corruptible world, but you are of an incorruptible race. If you are priests, as you are, if you are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, take care that you are clean before God. Let no impurity stain your body, for sin committed by the body grievously befouls the spirit and defiles the heart. Abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul." Those fleshly lusts belong to this present evil world, but you do not belong to it. You are strangers and pilgrims here. That's the word of God. "Therefore, feel an absolute alienation towards such things, an utter abhorrence of them. Do not even think of them, much less practice them. Abstain from fleshly lusts, for while they injure the body, that is not the worst thing that they do, for their war against the soul." So fleshly lust always hurts the soul.
They do not seriously injure to the body, but the main point for you to consider is that they war against our soul. So no man or woman can even commit an act of uncleanness of the body without grievously injuring the soul. It leaves a weakness, a defilement, a wound, a scar upon the soul. So may God graciously keep us from it altogether. D.L. Moody, another theologian, captured the essence of Peter's exhortation when he admitted, "I have more trouble with D.L. Moody than with any man I know. The man I see in the mirror each morning is my greatest impediment to holiness and godliness. So stop saying the devil made me do it. It's me. It's me, the man in the mirror." That's what D.L. Moody said. That is true self-evaluation and reflection. So Peter uses the word beloved, which means it's a love called out of one's heart by preciousness of the object love. The beloved are those to whom Christ has shown love, reminding us that God loves us. So Peter urges us to be dedicated to relentless and even ruthless opposition to the power of sin in our lives, which constantly seek to be master over us. Peter knows the point that being a slave to sin can bring, and he's exhorting believers, enabled by the supernatural power of the Spirit, to put to death the deeds of the body. The present tense, dear friends, beloved, I warn you, as temporary residents and foreigners, to keep away from worldly desires that wage war against your souls. Speak of continuous activity, every day, renewing of the spirit, renewing of the mind, because we don't know the war is incessant, which is constant. Whether you are 16, 50, or 76, we all go through it. When you're in this body, you're going through it. So all are warned of the necessity to be watchful, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion who walketh about seeking whom he may devour. So God's brand, what are you doing to it? God's brand is proof point. So when we see a cross, we think of Christ's sacrifice, his life, and what it means to follow him. And in the book of Revelation, God stamped his name upon the heads of the 144,000 to show others that they are of his brand. Branding is all over the Bible. I want you to know that it's not a new marketing term. It's all over the Bible. From God-given Cain to Mark, that let others know to back off to Jesus, comparing the kingdom of heaven to a mustard seed. As noted earlier, brand is not an image or a logo. A brand is not a word or a slogan. These are parts of the brand making. They are known as brand identity. But brand does not equal brand identity, but a brand boils down to its core essence at the heart. And at the heart is the reputation of God, God's proof point. So God showed me something. He said, "Let me show you where I put my seal on." And we find this sentiment with brand equals reputation in the third commandment. Exodus 20, verse 7 states, "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain." Simply put, God tells his people not to take his name in vain. And when I was growing up, I would hear this all the time. I think all of us can attest to that on social media, on Zoom, wherever you are connecting this morning. That when you were growing up, our elders used to say, don't take the Lord's name in vain. And we assume here that God is asking that we don't use his name in swear words. And that was how it was kind of wrapped when it was stated or in common colloquialism. At least that's what I grew up understanding. And God may very well may not want us to do that, but this commandment is saying so much more. And it's relevant today. When I saw all the transpiring from the ending of last year into this 7 days of this new year, it is God telling his people that he is very serious about his brand, his reputation. And we should make sure we are committed to it as much as he is. I feel like saying that again. The third commandment, it is God telling his people that he's very, underscore that, serious about his brand, his reputation. And we should make sure we are committed to it as much as he is. We should make sure that we are protecting it and guarding it. We should make sure we are upholding it. So this brings me to, like I said, I spent 30 years almost in marketing. So as I put my secular knowledge and my biblical knowledge together, just kind of meld the two together, and it brings me to a concept known as personal brand. So personal brand says that we each individually represent something to those who observe us. What's your brand? What are you telling the world that you are? And if what we personally represent is not congruent, and I'm not driving anybody to go, to Google to look up words that I'm saying this morning, but congruent is matching or being consistent, right? Represent is not congruent, which it means it's not matching or being consistent with the organization which you and I belong to. We have the ability to cast our brand, that reputation upon the organization's brand for better or for worse. I feel like bringing that again. So personal branding says that if we each individually represent something to those we that observe us, if what we personally represent is not congruent, meaning matching or consistent with the organization we belong to, we have the ability, we now have the ability to cast our brand upon the organization's brand, their reputation, for better or for worse. You have the ability to change a brand if you are not consistent with what has been outlined or supposedly perceived. So the following marketing and brand code says for any organization, its reputation is communicated by its employees. You are the brand. When you walk out there, whatever company you're with, you are carrying the brand. The customers perceive the brand of the company by its employees. And of course, in a religious setting, this principle wouldn't just apply to the church members, but to all Christians everywhere. When we say that we are Christians, and as believers, we convey God's reputation to the world collectively. That's heavy. But it's true. So what I said this morning is, I don't think I have an attitude. I have an attitude about anyone not representing my God's brand in the right light. I have an attitude about it. I don't think I have an attitude. I have one. Because your personal brand is being imposed on the original brand. And unfortunately, there have been many Christians and non-Christians who have misrepresented God's brand over the years. And now we find ourselves in a world where people don't really know what to think when they hear the word God. We're in a conundrum. We're in a state of affairs and problems. In other words, God's brand has suffered to the point that many don't know anything about him. Or if they do, they don't want nothing to do with him. So going back to the third commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. If we can't be serious about living our lives the way God asks us to, and if we are going to misrepresent who he is in his love and goodness and glory, then we should disassociate and not call ourselves his people. That sounds harsh, right?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, sis. Amen. Because I can tell you the real facts. In corporate, which I've been for almost 30 years, there's something called a code of conduct. And when you go against the code of conduct, if you do anything that's not in alignment with the code of conduct, you're fired. You are fired. You are barred from returning back to that company. So if you are misrepresenting who God is and tarnishing the brand and the reputation of God, then you should disassociate
Amen. Lose your
and
life.
call yourselves its people. But there is, oh, I just heard my husband say, repent. People like to say, I'm repented, but there's no change. I want to add change to that. Because you can repent and bawl and carry on all day long. But if your heart is not changed, repentance didn't come. So let's give repentance a brand new definition. It has to come with change. It must align with change. This is not to say that, you know, that ever so often, you know, we can't act foolishly because we all do. I'm not going to stand here and be sanctimonious because we all have come short of the glory of God. We all have shortcomings. I'm not saying that you can't call yourself a Christian if you fall. No. But it simply means that we need to pay close attention to the God we love and worship and represent and ask ourselves this question. When others see me, am I upholding God's brand? Or am I sirloining, meaning ruining and smearing it? I dare to ask that question again. When others see me, am I, like I said, self-reflection. Am I, not my neighbor, don't look over the other fence, please. Am I, it's me, Lord, the one that's looking in the mirror at myself. Am I upholding your brand? Or am I to lying, ruining, shaming, smearing it. What am I doing? So my challenge is one, not of condemnation, but of self-evaluation and reflection. Are you accurately representing God's brand to observers, to people that is looking on you, to people that are on the outside hoping to cross over to this side? Are you drawing them close or are you pushing them further away from God? What are you doing to the brand? Because the brand has suffered. Let's change that. Let's bring his brand back by showing the world the most powerful brand testimony they've ever seen, that Christians who love and want to serve others as Christ has loved and served us. Because I'm a firm believer that it is our life work to continue to work towards this brand, so that when others look on us, they see the God that we represent and want to serve him ever the more. I'm affirmed by that this morning because 2 Corinthians 5 and 20 perfectly states it. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. We are ambassadors for Christ. We carry the brand. So what are we doing? Are we upholding or are we ruining and smearing the brand? The next point is God's brand is his timeless words. His timeless words that illuminate the essence of God's brand. It is love as the core brand value. His love is the core of the brand value. And 1 John 4, verse 7 says, beloved, let us love one another. For love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. It's a symbol of redemption. John 3, verse 16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. That whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. It's a tagline of compassion. Psalms 145 and verse 8 says, the Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. It's the product line of spiritual treasures. Romans 6 and 23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The customer service through prayer. Philippians 4 verse 6 says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. It's inclusion. 1 Timothy 2, 3 and 4 says, this is good and pleasing in the sight of God, our Savior, who wants everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. It's guidance and support. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your path. He will make your path straight. It's eternal brand presence. And Matthew 28 and 20 says, I am with you always to the end of the age. This is the bow on it this morning, God's brand. These scriptures are the beacon of light, guiding us on the path of righteousness and love, forming the foundation of God's brand. Let us embrace and embody God's brand in our lives. Let us be ambassadors of love and mercy and compassion. In a world where brands are rising and falling, let us stand firm in enduring this brand. Let's uphold this brand. The brand of the Almighty God. Let's stand for something. Let's stand for this brand. If you don't stand for anything, you will fall for everything. I want you to know that. If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for everything. Stand for the brand. Stand for holiness. Stand for righteousness. Stand. I want you to stand. God wants you to stand. Because I'm telling you that when you don't stand, you're silently confirmed with what's happening. You're saying that, but I didn't do it. But you're not standing for it to say it's wrong. So you're agreeing with it. How about we stand in 2024? I said new level, next level. What does that mean? It's having faith in God. It's having a vision, a plan. And remaining focused on God. What are you standing for? How are you upholding God's brand? Because as you uphold his brand, he will lead you all the way. He will move you from the back to the front. He will give you a seat at the table. He will part the Red Sea for you. Don't make concessions. Don't water down the gospel. It will stand for ages. And it will stand the test of time. Stand for holiness. Stand for righteousness. Stand for the brand. Uphold the brand. Guard the brand. Protect the brand. Speak for the brand. Represent the brand. Lead with the brand. Like I said, I told my daughter, I said, there's two things. Who are you loyal to? Are you loyal to God or are you loyal to man? It's not both. It's It's one or the other. It's either God or man. And if the man and woman that you're following is contrary to the word, you got a decision to make. You know, I saw a clip from Cece this week, and she said, hold me accountable. If I'm every day I'm showing up different, hey, you got to hold me accountable. That was powerful. If I'm doing something wrong, don't agree with it, call me out on it. It's high time that we rise and we uphold the brand. And this week brought a lot of reflection my way. And I, you know, because I was once in a setting where it was something took place. And I didn't stand. And this week when a lot of things just taking place and people calling out and others and so forth and so on. And I remember that situation. That situation came to my mind. And I was like, you know, I should have gotten up and walked out. But I use culture to dismiss what happened. I didn't stand. And I said, God, I should have stand. I should have stood up and walk out. Not shame anybody, but a silent walkout would say, I don't agree with that. I said, God, this year, as you draw me into more knowledge and understanding of who you are and who I need to be and who and how I need to represent you, I now know what I need to do. I don't need to shame anybody in public, but I need to stand for righteousness. I need to stand for holiness and not be a part of the in crowd because everybody's doing it. Doesn't mean that it's right. Just because everybody is doing it doesn't mean it's right. What does God say? I think that should be our question this year. Will God agree with this move? Will God agree with this statement? Will God agree with this action? What does God say? Because he speaks. He's very loud. He's very clear. And he speaks in simple terms that you and I cannot misconstrue, but we will understand. What does God say? Is this a God move or my move? Which one is it? Let's stand for something. Let's stand for holiness and righteousness. The manuscript is right there before us. Let's uphold the brand. This year, let there be a change. Let us not be complicit with things that are going on. If it don't feel right, it ain't right. If it don't look right, it ain't right. If you got a question if it's right or wrong, it ain't right. That inner man called the Holy Spirit will never steer you the wrong way. I further explained to my daughter that when I got saved and, you know, back in the day as a young child growing up, you know, you want your clothes a certain way. And You're trying to fit in. So before I got saved or half saved, I liked a certain type of clothes. But when I got saved, it wasn't Sister White, now call her Mother White, and she's still alive, praise God, that chastised me. It wasn't Sister Marvelly. It wasn't all the mothers of old that took us under their wings. Because if they had chastised me, I don't think I would have even changed. So when I had this conversation with my daughter, I said to her, it was a day and a moment that I can't forget. When I put on the dress that I wanted to wear to church, I couldn't stop pulling it down. All of a sudden, a dress that I love to wear, I couldn't stop pulling it down. I kept pulling and pulling, and it wouldn't get longer. And when I looked in the mirror, I was tucking and pushing, and I was like, what's wrong? I didn't have a problem before. Why am I having a problem today? And I realized that that dress was not God's brand. And I took it off and put on something that represented Him. It was a Holy Spirit inside of me bringing conviction that I couldn't deny. I couldn't shirk. Like I said, it wasn't Sister Marvin Lee, it wasn't Mother White. It was the Holy Spirit that came over me that morning that made me talk and pull until I took it off. Because it wasn't representing God anymore. The person I used to be, I was no longer. The things I desired were no longer a part of this brand, this new brand that I've joined. It didn't fit. And my life has never been the same. An encounter happens. In this brand, there's an encounter that happens that you can't deny. When you have an encounter, the brand becomes you, and you become the brand. If you're still doing everything you used to do before, you haven't had an encounter with the brand. You think you did, but you have not had an encounter, a true encounter with the brand. Do you think the folks at Coca-Cola will drink a Pepsi? No. Because they're sold out to the brand. They won't go over to the competition for nothing. They're die-hardened people that are. They love the brand. Starbucks. Every morning, they got to go get their Starbucks. They will pass Dunkin' Donuts on their way, and they will go 10 miles out of their way to go get the Starbucks. They're sold out to the brand. So how we have allegiance to the worldly brands, where some of us will not put on a Puma because we love Nike, or vice versa. How about we try building God's brand the same way and even more so? Our allegiance to the brand. Just like certain music, some of us are sold out to certain music because that's our brand, that's our thing. How about we have an allegiance to God in the same way? A onward, Christian soldier. That's who we are. 2024, be that for us. Because it's a new level. It's a new level of worship. It's a new level of praise. It's a sold out praise and worship with God. I'm sold out to Him. That's the banner that we're raising and waving and leading with. And I pray that you uphold the bread. Amen and amen. As it is so. It is so. Lead with the word. The word doesn't lie. Lead with the word. Pray that this word blesses you today. Pray that it blessed you today. I pray that this word seep into your spirit today. Because you have an opportunity to make it right. You have an opportunity to transform and renew. Once life is still in the vessel, you have that opportunity. Like I said, I went to a funeral yesterday. That person is silenced forever. There's no more. But you and I woke up this morning. And you have the opportunity to stand up for holiness, to stand up for righteousness, to stand up for God's brand. And He will lead you all the way. Father, I just want to thank you today for your love. I thank you, Lord God, for your words. That is so quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. I thank you for the rod of correction today, Lord. I thank you for the reminder and the self-evaluation, Lord. Lord God, that when we seek you, we will find you. When we knock at your door, the door shall be open, Lord. And you provide instruction and correction and guidance in every step of the way along this life's journey. And Lord God, we submit ourselves to you, Lord God. We submit our ways to you. We submit our lives to you, Lord. And Father, I pray that if there's anything within us that don't belong, please take it out of us. Put us on the potter's clay, on the potter's wheel, and mold us and shape us into who you have called us to be. Father God, let us not lean on our own understanding, but in all our ways, let us acknowledge you, because you will direct our path. It's not what feels good, but what is the right thing to do? What is a just thing to do? What do you say? I thank you, Lord, for what you are going to do, for the revelation, for the manifestation. The remnant is rising. The clarion call has been given. The call of action has been released. And so, Lord, we humbly fall before you today. And we say, here I am. Here I am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. Willing and able to submit my will unto you. I give you thanks and I give you praise. And I glorify your name. And I say amen, because it is so. Thank you today for joining Recharge Ministries. Pastor Mark, Carleen Hepburn, we're honored to be called in the season. to be a part of the mouthpieces that are willing to speak the word of God without any apologies, without any misrepresentation of who God is. Because he's coming back again. He's coming back. Will you be among the ones that he will say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Or depart from me, I know you not." We're praying for you and with you. But just know that when you seek him, you will find him. God bless you today.
Amen.
God bless you today. Receive the word of the Lord. God bless you.
Hallelujah.